Scene one is a street corner. It is the night of a big union drive. The Moll stands at the lamppost. There is a phone attached to it.
I'm checking home now. Call it a night. Going up to my room. Turn off the light. Jesus, turn off that light. I ain't in Steel Town long. I work 2 days a week. The other five my effort days require. For 2 days out of seven, $2 bills I'm giving. So I'm just searching along the street for all those
the gent. The gent propositions the Moll. They haggle over a price. Their voices rising. Enter the Dick.
What's going on here?
He threatens to pull them both in and gets money from the gent, who leaves hastily. Then the Dick tries to make the Moll. She gets angry.
Come on, you love. Don't put me in the jug. You think you're wise. You think you own me. I'll show you guys.
Hello, Dick talking. What's up? Square in front of union headquarters? Who phoned in? Virgil? Go on. 8 of them. What are they, strikers? Listening to a speech, is that all? Say, listen, you know Virgil. He's an officer. Wait a minute. Here he comes now.
You're all under arrest.
Arrest?
What officer?
You can't arrest us.
Do we look like union organizers?
Do we look like steel workers?
Man.
I said you're under arrest.
I represent by Mr. Mister.
Yes, Mr. Mister.
You can't do that to us, Mr. Mister.
The man
who was making the speech.
It was him you were supposed to arrest.
Then what do you want to run for?
Oh, this is the Croon.
Croon.
What a word. Nice job, huh? Just like that. Wasn't out 5 minutes. 8 of them. Count them. What do you got there, Dick?
Ah, little hustler.
Hustler?
We can take them all in together.
Suits me, only these are mine.
Together?
With that?
With her? You know who we are.
You fool.
Idiot. Imbecile.
Moron.
Yeah.
Oh, calling me names now, huh?
Go right ahead. You only happen to be arresting the newly formed Liberty Committee.
Oh, yeah? What's that?
You never heard of the Liberty Committee?
Did you ever hear of the Daughters of the American Revolution?
You ain't one of them, are you? Hey, did you say revolution? I knew it. Come on!
Scene three, a mission. 1915.
My dear Mrs. Mister.
Reverend Salvation, how are you? It's been weeks I wanted to meet you and to greet you. I'm a stray lamb, too. And I brought along our monthly present. But one thing is not so pleasant, Father dear. I feel that things may now continue forever. Hard times, I can assure you. Hard times for us and for you. Hard times, Father, what can we do? The market hasn't been ideal. We have to sell our steel to French or English or German. Though the latter are vermin. Father, please, in your sermon, Sunday, I rely upon you to implore that we stay out of the war.
Thou shalt not kill. It's in the Bible, so must it be. Thou shalt not kill. Peace on earth, towards men goodwill. Now. nothing but goodwill. As your shepherd I implore, turn from thoughts of wicked war, for we do abhor. Will and save your husband, sons, and men be resolute, refuse to choose. Or into the lonesome fray we'll be tossed. Everything be lost, oh peace at any cost.
Collection.
The next year, 1916...
Reverend Salvation, I'm worried. Things are not proceeding so nicely or precisely in the way they should. And my husband, Mr., said it's something about bank credit. Bob, dear, they feel for steel and oil and rubber. So we must set the town right. Please don't be quite so downright. Simply answer both yes and no. It's true you preach so much for peace, but now it seems that peace may be a little expensive. Oh, please don't think me offensive. Just restrain your attentive ardor. You might mention that you do deplore the German side of the war.
South, out, not. Righteousness conquers iniquity, perishes. Peace is a wonderful thing. But when I say peace, I'm referring to inner peace. Let there be no misconception. The peace you remember, which passes beyond understanding. We must remember our honor and the valor and pride which is ours to cherish and use. Knowing well that peace without honor, no good American should excuse. Surely I need not remind you of the war which is simply dreadful for everyone. There we take no side, still we know who defends. We keep from the savage hunt.
Collection.
But in 1917...
Reverend Salvation! News! Front page news, headline news, strictly mine, confidential news, but such news as my husband in a back of the Congress. He said the short way we move on from, so all things, everything's ready for the first gun.
Daily of the Steeltown News.
Charge?
Ah, the same, I guess.
You know about these things. What have I got them for? Loitering? Obstructing traffic?
Change that to read procurer, also known as pimp. To Mr. Mister, to Sister Mister, to Junior Mister.
Scene 4. The lawn of Mr. Mister's home. Enter Junior Mister and Sister Mister, each reclining in a hammock.
Junior.
Leave me alone.
What is this
writer going to
do?
Don't bother me. I'm busy. Croon, croon till it hurts, baby. Croon, my heart asserts, baby. Crooning in spurts, baby, is just a nurse for a tune. A blessed one. He makes the population happy. For when all one's cares have distressed one.
Oh, the spoon is grand in the doomsday sky. Your spoon and spooning never gets tired. But it's nicer at night than in the noonday sun. Cause then you get
even the poor are not immune. If they're without a suit, they shouldn't give a hoot when they can substitute.
Find me a dreamland and leave us to dreamland where me and my dreamland
can. When they can substitute.
You too unduly. I have business with Editor Daly.
Should I wear stripes or checks? All the problems of my attire. Excuse me, I gotta make another long distance call to Esquire.
And I got a date with a fig. Get it?
Children are rather witty. I have called you here fairly early, my dear, at your daily, because I have something on my mind.
All my gift of prose will be at your disposal, Mr. Mister, you've been very kind.
I believe newspapers are great mental shapers. My steel industry is dependent on them, really.
Just you call the news and we'll tell all the news from coast to coast and from border to border.
Yes, but some news can be made to order.
Oh, the press, the press, the freedom of the press. They'll never take away the freedom of the press. We must be free to say whatever's on our chest. With a hey diddle dee and a ho nonny no, for the Kevin and I will pay the best.
I should like a series on young Larry Foreman, who goes around storming an organizing union.
Yes, we've heard of him, in fact. Good word of him, he seems quite popular with working men.
Find out who he drinks with and talks with and sleeps with and looks up his past till at last you've got it on him.
But the man's so full of fight, he's simply dynamite. Why, it would take an army to tame him.
Then it shouldn't be too hard to frame him.
Oh, the press, the freedom of the press.
You've only got to give whatever's fit to print. If something's wrong with it, why then we'll print the fifth.
With a hey diddle dee and a ho nonny no, for the Kevin Knight will pay the best. And his picture still the front page of your paper, this drunkard and raper who's out to gull the people.
Just a minute, I'm not
not being indiscreet, I must consult the owner of my sheets.
Please don't try to cross your good humor, new boss. I'm the owner of your famous paper since this morning.
In that case, I wonder if my place is not worth more. The other crowd would like me to shake you.
Then you'll see just how neatly I'll break you.
Oh, the press, the press, the freedom of the press. They'll never take away the freedom of the press.
That Coleman series now.
Yes, mister, mister, yes.
With a hey, diddle, dee, and a ho, nami, no.
No!
Yes, sir, yes, yes. For whichever type
will pay
the best. I agree with you absolutely, Mr. Mister.
Now, that's a big relief, Editor Daly.
You see, I was literary advisor for years to Princess Walla Walla Hawani of the Hawaiian Islands. We still correspond.
Then you're just the man to write the manifesto for my Liberty Committee.
If I do say so myself.
Literary advisor to a princess. What do you know?
Yes, well, spelling and things, you know.
Oh, yes, about Junior.
I do like Junior.
He doesn't go so well with union trouble. I want him out of town, say, on the paper. A correspondence job or something, see?
Your Junior? Working? Yes, I see.
Family to Lulu, sail away to that fair land. That's just the isle for you, and you'll have your work too. A little scribbling on your father's journal. Oh, nothing ever happens over there.
Don't they say the climate's fresh and burn now?
You can play the ukulele.
Now, Junior, listen to Editor Daly.
Have you been to Honolulu?
Are the women nice down there?
Demure and so highborn, just pure September morn.
I don't care if they are highborn, just as long as they are high-breasted.
Junior, please don't get arrested.
Picture when the sun sets in Oahu. That's the island Honolulu's on. Dusky maidens dancing in the starlight.
What's some young
debutante
to do,
sir? You'd be our official correspondent.
You're a fool if you don't go now.
La, 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 la. La, 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 la.
Junior's gonna go to Honolulu. Junior's gonna be a journalist.
Can I drive over 80 miles an hour?
Ruby lips are waiting to be kissed.
I'd be satisfied with one thing, Lulu.
Chocolate arms are open like a flower.
How the hell do you spell Honolulu?
Junior's gonna be a journalist.
There's a woman there who wants you.
La, 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 la.
Have you been to Honolulu? Sail away to that island.
Dusky maidens in the starlight.
Order in the courtroom!
Next case. Name?
Harry Brother.
Usual charge, I suppose.
You know this one. I picked him up in the square earlier in the evening.
Wait a minute.
I belong with these people. I sold out, too. I sold out my boy and two others with him.
Scene two is the night court. Harry Druggist sits alone on the bench. He is a derelict and talks to the clerk. Enter with commotion the Liberty Committee and the Moll. The committee yelled loudly for Mr. Mister to come and bail them out. One of those agitators was making a speech. They were listening, and the cop arrested them by mistake. The Moll sits beside the druggist. He tells her the Liberty Committee members really belong in the night court, even though the cop did get his signals mixed. There was much fussing and protesting among the members of the committee. Finally, the clerk calls, "Order in the courtroom!" And the first case is called, Reverend Salvation. The clerk asks the charge, the cop hesitates and blunders, and it is the druggist who whispers,
"Oh, they got old man Salvation in the night court at last. You know what the charge ought to be? Habitual prostitute since 1915.
Scene five, a drugstore.
Steve?
Yes, Pop?
Those glasses, really clean this time. Like that. That's the way. It looks like summer weather. There's a fine, warm sun. I swear I'd not change places with King Solomon. I ought to make you pay for every glass that you drop. It certainly feels fine to own my shop."
Oh, Pop, you're always such a crazy. This shop's not yours. What about the mortgage?
The mortgage now. You know how much it worries me. I saw the man again. Told him to let me be. I'll pay him when I can. You know who owns the company. It's Mr. Mister. Tell me, what does he want with my little cash? It's a terrible world, Stevie. And I feel fine.
You're the guy that runs this joint?
I'm the proprietor.
You know a Polack who comes in here every Sunday?
A Polack?
Sure, a punk. With his wife, he comes here. You know, Pop, he means that Polish fellow.
He brings his wife here every week about this time. She likes my ice cream soda. Yes, I know them well.
Huh, you know what he looks like, huh?
Yes, why?
You'd like to keep this drugstore, wouldn't you? You wouldn't want any company to clamp down on your mortgage or anything like that now, would you?
What's the idea?
Here's the dope. When this Polack comes in today, you don't say nothing. He goes out. There's a big noise outside. You don't say nothing, nothing, understand? You'll keep your trap shut. But when they ask you later on who's done it, you remember it's this here Polack.
Then what?
Explosion. They're taking a little piece off Union headquarters across the street.
Well, who is?
None of your damn business. Geez, I don't know why the boss had to pick you out of all the stores on this side. Talk about dumb.
The boss? Mr. Mister's behind there someplace, Pop.
I don't know that name. I've never heard that name before. Get me?
But, man, I can't say that somebody did something when they didn't. Suppose he denies it.
Listen. I'll go over it all again. There's gonna be an explosion. This guy's gonna be any explosion. He ain't gonna body in on that to that.
And his wife, too.
And I help it if his wife never lets him out of her sight.
Pop, I heard what he said. Pop, you're not gonna get away with it.
You keep your shirt on. You don't want to interfere with your own man.
Steve, they got me cornered. I'll lose the store. They can do it. I'll lose everything. They got me, Stevie. What shall I do?
Pop, shut up now. Here they come.
What store
are
you going to get it?
Up on High Street.
Hey, fancy shop, I bet, huh?
No, it ain't, and it's the cutest dress.
Sadie, you got new dress already. What do you want? Take all my money.
I know, but God.
It's pretty dress.
Oh, God, if you could only see me in it.
All right. Maybe they make me head guy at noon, and I got plenty money. What'd you take? Same thing?
Vanilla ice cream soda with 2 scoops.
Me nothing. Oh, just Coca-Cola. Wait, with shot lemon, maybe. Manager come to me yesterday, say I keep away from union, I get good job. Then Larry Foreman, union fella, he come to me, say, Gosh, don't be fool, you belong with us. Look like I very popular. Everybody want me. I don't know. Say, are you going to have a kid soon? I want a kid. I want a son. What I care what they hear. Now I got first papers. Pretty soon I going to be real American citizen. Fellas say they need men like me. Sure, good hands, strong. You say America need men like me. Sadie, I think maybe you getting big already. We're going to buy you a new kind dress soon, huh?
God, stop it.
Why don't my Sadie tell me she gonna have baby?
Now, Gus, I ask you twice today, don't talk that way.
What I care, what they hear. I make a little bed from wood, so my son sleep good. So my son sleep good. We wonder if anyone could be as much in love as me. We wonder if anyone ever loved me more. They couldn't be anymore.
Concerts last year.
Last year I sold 12 pictures. Last year, how about this year?
This year I rely on my talent.
Prospects are lousy for me too. Don't let me keep you. Please be on your way. You must have many things to do.
No, not at all. An appointment today brings me to these parts.
Me too.
But the person I'm about to meet, I doubt you could have met her. The kind of grovel that my feet keep staying if I let her. She's fabulously wealthy, and although that's not the reason, I think she can be counted on to subsidize me all next season.
Your lady friend does resemble a lot someone, and that's very queer.
Oh.
Someone who's meeting me here.
No.
Is her pierce arrow light blue?
Yes.
Not Mrs. Mister.
Well, yes, Mrs. Mister.
Me too.
Oh, there's something so damn low about the rich. They're fantastic, they're far-fetched, they're just funny. They've no impulse, no fine feeling, no great itch.
What have they got? What have they got?
What have they got?
Money. Stupid woman, Mrs. Mister.
Stupid. What she doesn't know about music would put Heifetz back on his feet again.
She asked me to bring El Greco to tea this summer.
This summer? Oh, so she mentioned the summer to you.
Did she say where she will be? No, but we both thought that Paris would do, or Capri. She called it Capri.
Why, she promised me Bar Harbor with an extra house where I... But, of course, if she has other plans, I've other fish to fry.
Well, dear Lady Duchess desperately wants me at her place. She's had everyone do our three quarters. I'm to do full face.
And I just heard from Marquesa Contessa last week. She was Matilda McGee.
Well,
now she's divorced the Marquis.
Hell, my Lady Duchess loves me.
Well.
But to wed wealth, so I fear, would affect my career.
Oh, I agree.
For there's something so damn low about the rich. It's incredible the open way they court you. All these millionaires, I can't tell which is which.
What can they do?
What can they do?
What can they do? Support you.
It's part for our sake.
sake, with your heart for our sake, and your mind for our sake, be blind for our sake, and deaf for our sake, and dumb for our sake, until for our sake, they kill for our sake, while we are for our sake.
Scene 7 is back in the night court again. The Liberty Committee is restless and fidgety. Will Mr. Mister never come? Did you phone to Mr. Mister? What'd he say? What'd he say? Mr. Mister's not at home. Had a meeting with the board. Said the judge is with him too. He'll come over right away, just as soon as they get through. What'd he say? What'd he say? He'll come over right away. They talk of Larry Foreman, the labor organizer who made the speech, who is being grilled outside. He's the one who started this. The Moll sits quietly on the railing in the half light. She begins to speak, and then she sings.
It was Tuesday last week. Yeah, Tuesday. I had breakfast at Andy's. Coffee and. For lunch, I had coffee and again. For dinner, I could only afford coffee. Then I looked on the floor, and I see a nickel shining there. Gee, coffee and Andy. Then I looked closer. Well, that wasn't no nickel. Not coffee and Andy, just coffee Andy. Cute, huh? Mister, you don't know what it felt like thinking that was a nickel under my foot.
Oh, boy! I've just been grilled.
Say, who made up that word grilled? I also been barbecued, frizzled, and pleated.
Say, what's the whole Liberty Committee doing in a night court? And on the wrong side of the bar? Wait till I tell my Aunt Jessie. She's got a comeback for everything. Understand, there's the biggest cheats and whores in town.
Excuse the language, miss. My Aunt Jessie gets all them big words out of the Bible. You're new here. What's the matter? They catch you on the streets, kid?
Uh-huh. What have they got you for?
Who, me?
Making a speech and passing out leaflets. The formal charge is inciting to riot. Ain't you ever seen my act? Well, I'm creeping along in the dark. My eyes is crafty. My pockets is bulging. I'm loaded, armed to the teeth with leaflets. And am I quick on the draw? I come up to you very slow, very snaky. And with one fell gesture, I tuck a leaflet in your hand. And then, one, two, three, there's a riot. You're the riot. I incite you. I'm terrific, I am.
That don't sound like nothing to get arrested for. Besides, you don't seem very worried.
Listen, girl, you don't want to talk like that. That's dangerous talk. First thing you know, they'll have you deported as well as fumigated. But it's a good leaflet. We printed it ourselves. Sure, we got a committee, too. Farmers and city people. Doctors, lawyers. Even a couple of poets. And one preacher. We're middle class. We all got property. We also got our eyes open. This crowd here, hiding up there in the cradle of the Liberty Committee. Up on the topmost bough of yonder tree now, like bees in their hives, the lords and their lackeys and wives, a swinging rockabye baby in the nice big cradle. Then they remark, the air is chilly up there, the sky be brown, can that be a cloud over there? And then they put out their hands and feel stormy weather. A birdie ups and cries, boy, this looks bad, you haven't used your eyes, you'll wish you had. That thunder, that lightning, and it's going to surround you. No wonder those storm birds seem to circle around you. When you can't climb down and you can't sit still, that's a storm that's going to last until when the wind blows, and when the wind blows, the cradle will rock. That thunder, that lightning, and it's going to surround you. No wonder those storm birds seem to circle around you. When you can't climb down and you can't say no, you can't stop the weather, not with all your dough. When the wind blows, when the wind blows,
Larry talks of the union drive going on in the square. The Boilermakers and their kids with bugles, the Ruffers' kids with drums, the Rollers' kids with fifes, all standing waiting for the good news. He is interrupted by the next case in the night court, President Prexy of College University and Professors Mamie, Scoot, and Trixie. Scene 8 is the faculty room. Mr. Mister has come to look over the professors. He wants one to make a speech at his rally for compulsory military training next Saturday night. President Prexy, anxious to please, calls in Mamie, Scoot, and Trixie. Each one puts on an act for Mr. Mister, and President Prexy stands hopefully by to see which one will please. Mamie is very vague, scientific, arch. Mr. Mister finds him too highbrow. Scoot turns out to be a Tolstoyan who doesn't like war, who stayed in Henry Ford's peace ship during the last one. He is booted out without delay. Trixie, football coach, also elementary French, does the trick with a pep talk to the boys. On army training, part in a storm. There's nothing like a uniform. Stick your chest out. Be a man. Trixie is selected. Great joy, even a little dance, which passes without transition to scene 9, doctor's office. We are now dealing with the next case in the night court, doctor specialist. Mr. Mister is a hypochondriac. He imagines he has all sorts of ills. Dr. Specialist reassures and cajoles him, tells him it's just nerves. Ella Hammer is announced. Mr. Mister remembers her brother, a machinist, was hurt at the mill. Rumors have it he was pushed into a ladle because his union activities had made him an undesirable character. Mr. Mister wants the doctor to testify the man was drunk at the time. The doctor is shocked. The man was certainly not drunk when he examined him. Mr. Mister tries persuasion, then threats, and finally a hysterical fit in order to get the doctor to accede to his demand. The doctor stands silently, a battle going on within him. Mr. Mister leaves. Ella Hammer enters.
Hello, doctor. Doctor, you examined Joe. Doctor, you're the one to know. If he ever touched a drop of liquor, he couldn't hold it. You know his stomach. They've taken up out of his paycheck for you to know his stomach by now.
Yes?
Is the rumor true that they mean to say that he was drunk?
Yes?
But, doctor, you know those hoodlums framed him, pushed him into that ladle because he wasn't afraid to talk. He's been expecting this for weeks. He even told you that.
Yes?
Workers who have been cheated and lied to and sold out, they daren't trust anybody no more. They mustn't lose their faith in Joe now. You see that, don't you? So you will tell the worker it was all a frame-up. You'll say their confidence in him was not unfounded. I hope you will.
Reporters are here from the newspaper, sir.
Yes?
Good morning, Doctor. Mr. Mister sent us over here. We aren't quite sure what for.
Well, gentlemen, I'll be brief. My statement is this. I examined the man, Hammer, shortly after his injury at the Fieldtown Mills last Thursday. The man was obviously intoxicated. That's all.
But, Doctor, isn't there any more? That hardly makes a complete story.
A story? Is that what your papers want? A story?
Listen, here's a story. Not much fun and not much glory. Low class, slow down. The thing you never care to see until there is a showdown. Here it is. I'll make it snappy. Are you ready? Everybody happy? Don't work or get shipped. For no good reason, just shift. From the start until the finish comes, they feed them out of garbage cans, they bleed them in the slums. Joe, worker will go to shops where something's on show. He'll look at the meat, he'll look at the bread, and too little to eat, sort of goes to the head. One big question inside me cries, how many fakers keep undertakers, paid strike breakers, how many toiling, ailing, dying, piled up bodies, brother, does it take to make you wise? Right at his working he drops, weary, weary, tired to the core. And then if he drops out of sight, there's always 20 more. So, worker must know that somebody's got him in tow. But what is the good for just one to be clear? Oh, it takes a lot of Joes to make a sound you can hear. One big question inside me cries, how many frame-ups, how many shakedowns, lockouts, sellouts, how many times?
is back in the night court. The Liberty Committee has been there hours now. A subtle and agonizing fear steals over them. Larry talks to them gaily, but seriously too. He tells them they belong to a union already.
The Union of Associated Stooges. You're caught there, boys. You're stuck like a sandwich. In between the top crowd pressing down and the bottom crowd coming up. What do you want to be? Hamburgers, I ask you.
I've been looking all over town for you.
Well, how are the union returns?
They haven't come to a decision yet. Mr. Foreman, I know a lot about you. You were once in my employ. Look here, why don't you persuade your group to join with the Liberty Committee into one big united organization?
You mean with these people here?
Yeah, it's a bad mistake their being here. Release them at once. I told the judge to go on home. I have his authority. That includes you too, Mr. Foreman, of course.
You got his authority, eh?
Yes, my brother-in-law, you know.
Oh, yes. He's part of the Liberty Committee, too?
And some of the best people in town. Editor Daly over there. Dr. Specialist, you know him. And they're all very democratic. Come now, what do you say?
Let me understand you. You'd like my services in swinging your way all the people I've signed up. All the people who agree with the union, you want me to change their minds. Is that it?
Well, that's a little strongly put.
No, no. Oh, mister, you can be perfectly frank with me.
When all this trouble is over, I'll see to it personally that there's a wave of increased production. Improved methods, closer competition than the country's ever seen before.
Don't do it.
Do they know that I'm building them a swimming pool, a library, a private park for their children?
From where I sit, it looks like they only want a union.
I don't want to talk about your own future. There's nothing you couldn't be. I haven't time to argue. Well,
I might. That's a tall order, you know.
Well, of course, I don't expect you to do it just like that.
Murderer!
Want to be worth quite a lot to you, eh?
I thought so. You needn't worry about that part. I'll see you get what it's worth. Let's talk it over outside.
I'm kind of funny that way. I'd like to know now about how much it would be worth. You don't say. Worth that much for you, eh? Well, you take all that money and go buy yourself a big piece of toast. You want to relax. And to me and my Aunt Jessie, you're a poached egg.
What?
Maybe.
All right, now, get out of here and take a little girl with you. Out there, she don't cost you nothing. In jail, you're liable to have to feed her.
Why, you goddamn skunk. I'll break you. I'll run you out of town.
And give us front page publicity, would you, please?
Kill!
Yeah, kill Lynch. Listen, once for all, you scared bunch of ninnies outside the square to starting something that's going to tear the catgut out of your sticking racket. That's steel marching out in front. But one day there's going to be wheat and sidewalks, cows and music, shops, houses, homes, bridges, drugstores. The people of this town are growing up. They're finding out what it's all about. And when everybody gets together like Steele's getting together tonight, where are you then? Listen, you Black Legions, you Ku Kluxers, you Vigil Antis, hiding up there in the Cradle of the Liberty Committee. When the storm breaks, Cradle will fall. Listen. The Boilermakers are with us. That's the Boilermakers' kids.
The Rumpers.
The Rollers.
Steel. Your Steel. They done it.
They're marching down here. They got no permit to march.
Arrest them!
Arrest them! There's thousands of them! They're standing from the courthouse! Right here!
My God! What do they want of me? Don't worry, that's not for you. That's just my Aunt Jessie and her committee.
That's thunder, that's lightning, that's quite a